Good evening, good afternoon, everyone. This is actually, this, as I said, describing something no frills, go straight to the point. And I've been delivering this the last couple of weeks, mostly to all FW audiences, testing ideas, testing observations. And, it's interesting because OFW audiences are predominantly raw, literature, with a few critical. And so far, they've liked what I've said, both the anti and the pro, so they feel like it's fair and unbiased. But we'll see if the audience here would accept that. But what I would like to ask is actually to set aside your partisan, for the Filipinos at least, to set aside your partisan perspective or outlook and look at these issues. I'll try to give my own judgment, of course, and the overall judgment. But that comes from where I sit, from the things I care about the most, which might be different from each of you, so I'll talk about that as well. But it's a no-frills outline. I do want to start with the title. I mean, the age of the director, change has come, and it's both good and bad. It's a very different Philippines from a year ago, and it's both good and bad. Here to me, it's good and bad. There are good things and there are bad things. So the good, the bad, and there are things that are uncertain, that's still unfolding, that we need to follow and monitor and look at. The mother of all uncertainty, of course, the president's health. But those things we also have to look at. I do try in all of this as we go along, as well as the end, to address, because many here are citizens of the Philippines, and because I speak a lot to OFW audiences, both in Asia, Middle East, and Europe, I actually ask the question, what can citizens do for the good? Support it, consolidate the gains. For the bad, how do we change it? How do we address it? How do we correct it? And for the uncertain, how do we manage it so we end up in a safer and better place? Let's start with the good. It's always good to start with something positive. As a negotiator, I've learned that, and a teacher as well, that the first thing you'd always say about someone, about anyone, are good things. Because that makes them comfortable, that keeps us on a bad foot. So I want to start with the good. In my view, of course, Alvin can talk about Mahar as well, can talk as a social field. The two most important decisions that Duterte has made, most important to all people, all Filipinos, have been very good. The appointment of Banco Central ng Pilipinas Governor Espinilla. Perfect appointment. Everyone says this was the right man. He listened to the right people. Of course, the finance secretary. Most of all, he doesn't know Espinilla, no political connection at all, and he appointed him. That's the most important decision because it's about currency, it's about interest rates, it's about the macro economy, and you know, if we're going to be in good hands, regardless of what happens externally, you know, the economy will move. So that's very important to say that. The other one, which just happened this week, is the abandonment of government-to-government rice importation. I've followed this in the last 30 years, and the economic managers, economic people like Dr. Mas, have been pushing this. And in government, including in the last one, there's always been this attempt to try to do it. The reformers tried to do it, but they never could because of the vested interests. But this time around, aside from the economic managers, we have Secretary Ibasco, a truly advocate of the poor in the cabinet. He was defeated in the first round. In fact, his undersecretary got fired, you know that. But he did not surrender, he pushed back and pushed back. And finally got the president to agree. And in the last LFA meeting, he told the LFA administrator who's against this change, your responsibility is to approve in a ministerial way. No, you don't even have a discretion, which takes away the corruption element. You have to approve permits to import rice by private traders. Economists tell me that if this is done right and it's consistent, this is the best thing that will happen to food prices in the Philippines in the next months to come. So let's be very clear about that. On the three most important things that the Duterte administration had to do in its first year, it did the right thing. And this is so important, it had to go to the president. The good, the tax reform program, which passed the House and will go now to the Senate. There's lots of debate. I have a caveat on the impact on the poor because there's a debate about that and on the economies. I would not be able to judge the details. I know, for example, that William Monsoon has raised issues about what was passed in the House and Mens and Rana. These two economies are people I trust, actually, the judgments I trust have taken the opposite side. So certainly want to listen. And of course, it's the final package that matters, what comes out of the Senate for the tax reform package. But in any way, the approach is inclusive development, being the mantra of this administration. Again, something that would be good for the poor if we actually come up with, finally, the tax reform program. The fact that the Duterte government is pushing this is something I think quite important. Build. You know, for someone like me who travels everywhere in the Philippines and also always passing through our gate base, and also traveling various parts of developing countries, Africa, Asia, our neighbors in ASEAN, the Philippines is in bad shape infrastructure-wise, it really is. So I am in favor of this build, you know, the emphasis on build. I think actually DPWH is doing quite well, as good as it was under the Aquino administration. Mark Vigas brought in really good people also to do this. But my caveat, I do have a caveat, because these reports say that the private public partnerships approach has been discarded in favor of more government contracting and it can cause problems from a corruption point of view, and I wonder how fast actually it will be as well. There's a China aspect to this because a lot of the funding, it seems, for the construction will also come from China, and that doesn't necessarily have a good record in other parts of the world. I mean, so we'll see. But at least, again, for me, this is about inclusive development. If you build the infrastructure and build it across the country, you give access to people and you help the poor the most. Things are good. I think there are some departments, and I followed some of them just because of the nature of the work that I do, that have been very pro-poor. I mean, as expected, those that have been given to the left have been very consistently, honestly not even seeking a balance in their approach, but actually taking the sides of the constituents for which they were created. That's DAR, DSW, DNAPC. Although up to now they haven't really come up with a successful approach on contractualization, there is no societal consensus over that, with the private sector really quite opposed to major changes on contractualization and labor not willing to compromise on that. So that remains in the agenda. It's an important promise that the president made that has not yet been totally realized, even with the changes that have happened. I talked about Secretary Vasco. I follow that office. Incredible work being done by the cabinet secretary. Of course, he's overworked. Everything is being given to him, including Marawi rehabilitation. Obviously, the most trusted of the president in terms of this area of work. There was this issue on the urban poor, Kadamay, that might raise some alarm for some people, but for me, was resolved well. Urban poor took over housing units in Bulacan, and obviously there were concerns about rule of law because people just took over, and for a while, I thought that there would be violence and they would be evicted, but the government found a way forward. I think the most important lesson from there is those housing units, anyway, was not really acceptable to the recipients, the military and the police that were designed first of all, but it was actually framed there, or they were really being used for speculation anyway, and not for housing for the poor. And so I thought that the government did a really good job, I think that was under Secretary Vasco as well, of diffusing a situation. Although you probably don't want this to be your rule in terms of urban housing, where people just go take over government housing without following the legal rules. I mean, I would wish that they would no longer do this for the future. This is just too risky. I think NEDA has been very consistent also in inclusive development. So some insights I get that the left actually can govern. There's not major complaints. I mean, there are complaints, but not major complaints among the agencies that the people that were given to National Democrats to govern. They've done well. They brought in good people, competent people to work with them. They generally follow the rules. So I think that's a good experience. It also tells you it doesn't take rocket science to do right by the poor. You just have to take their side. If you were created for farmers, there are no brainer. You side with farmers all the time. There are landowners, then other agencies, you can go to court, but farm, you know, DAR should always take the side of farmers. Labor, those should always take the side of labor, no? BSW should always take the side of the poor. You should not need to balance if you were in the government and that was your agency. But good, I think in terms of many basic deliveries, so we would say education and health, for example, we've seen a continuation of what has been going on for a while now, K-12 being implemented. Lots of problems there, but nothing major to really stop it. There's a question of RH services, one of the biggest achievements of Aquino, but the Supreme Court has come in with a PRO that has affected some of the contraceptive material. We're still far away from universal health services, but you know, I mean, the reform for the health sector needs to be pursued and needs to be continuing. My insight from these reforms can survive change of administrations, and I think that's a welcome thing to say. The good, the peace processes, but this will segue to the bad, because the next slide is going to be about Malawi. The president and the president's people on peace has been very committed. The people are excellent, they're the best that you can get in this area. There's certainly a complete commitment to the more peace process with the MILF and the MNLF. In fact, more commitment also to the MNLF than there was in the previous administration with the MNLF. And when I talk about MNLF, the Niswari faction. At least Duterte is talking to the Niswari faction. Aquino did not. Obviously, that led to the Zamboanga siege, and if after the Zamboanga siege, even then, Niswari was really not someone that the President Aquino wanted to talk to. But Duterte has made an effort to talk to Niswari. Which means if those two processes are actually completed, at least the mainstream moral revolutionary groups are able to get an agreement. Although unfortunately there are new moral groups that we are now talking about that are more fundamentalist, that are more radical, that are more extremist. I've been following the peace process with the National Democratic Front for a while now. It's strange because the process is actually going very well. The people trust each other. They have very constructive meetings. They're able to move forward. But every once in a while, the president stops the process and suspends it because of an ambush here, of a statement here, etc. Which tells you that what you need to do is to accelerate the talks fast to get a bilateral ceasefire early. The problem is there's no ceasefire now, there's only unilateral ceasefires. As long as that is the case, I always tell my friends on both sides, as long as that is the case, you're always endangering the peace process. Any kind of atrocity by anyone, by the government or by the rebels, by the NPA, will lead to the scuttling of the talks. Sayang naman, they should make all of this effort. So, but they cannot get into a bilateral ceasefire because that needs concessions on substantive matters. And the concession will come on what's called the CASER negotiations, a comprehensive agreement on socioeconomic reforms, which is the first product of the peace process with the NDFP. I mean, the first product is done already, which is just immunities, etc. The next is comprehensive agreement on socioeconomic reforms, then followed by a political agreement, then followed by demobilization, the laying down of arms. That's really the whole process. I mean, and the envision a 2 to 3 year process for that. I think that will not work, a process that long. It has to be faster, and particularly get into a bilateral ceasefire faster. That's why the MILF process worked. First time around, during GMA, because we got a ceasefire fast. And then after Arab went on an all-out war, GMA got a ceasefire fast, and we had a long ceasefire that built trust between the military and the MILF. And then after a flare-up, when the Bangsamoro, the Mua Ibi, was declared unconstitutional by the court in 2008. The time I actually came in for the GMA government also to negotiate with the MILF, we also got quickly to a ceasefire. Without a ceasefire, kasi you really cannot progress too much because you're endangering the process all the time with things that you have no control over. Because the negotiators, quite honestly, do not have control over forces on the ground. And that applies not just to the rebels, but also to the Philippine military. Because military officials are empowered to make on-the-spot decisions in the field. In any case, I consider the positive, the president gets it, because without peace, we won't have development. The bad. And I start with the Marawi siege and what it signifies. Like many of these bad things and the good things as well, it is very important not to say this is Duterte's fault, but it is an accumulation of things. But it is his problem now. I think after 1 year, it is your problem, regardless of the roots of the situation. I mean, you have to own it. Otherwise, you don't have any business governing the country if you're going to give excuses that it was somebody's fault. In any case, the Marawi signal is bad. There's an intersection of terrorism and drugs there, I think, if you follow it. I mean, this is not a Duterte invention. Way back 2 to 3 years ago, Pancho Lara of International Road wrote a very important report pre-Duterte that showed how terrorism, drugs, even illegal mining, I mean, lots of illegal economic activities were all interconnecting in Mindanao. I mean, in any case, it's very important not to conflate the two. But if you conflate the two, especially if you say this is a drug problem more than a religious extremism problem, then you don't get the point. And after writing one of my students here, a paper called Opium of the People, following from Karl Marx, and on this conflation. Because the real opium of the people here is not the shampoo that they might be taking. I don't know if that's true or not. It's really the promise of martyrdom for the jihadists. I mean, let's be very clear about that. We have jihadists in the Philippines. We have jihadists in this region that are looking for a base. And it seems they found the right base, the right urban base for that. I mean, and I think it's a permanent feature. And hopefully it stays in Marawi and not transfers to other Mindanao cities. Ironically, if you actually destroy Marawi, President again just made a statement, he will carpet bomb Marawi if necessary to save the lives of soldiers. If you actually do that, that's your guarantee it spreads. Right? Because then you'll look for the other, for the next city, that they will induce the government to carpet bomb and destroy, they will do that. I mean, the nature of these terrorists is that they can go from one place to another. And it doesn't matter how many you kill of them. You know that. You've seen that in other parts of the world. So we have to address the problem of religious extremism directly, I mean, and not not conflate it with other issues, not de-emphasize it. And here the link to the peace process is important. I think that this should be a problem that should be led mainly by the Moro groups, the Moro governance people. The MILF and the MMLF in this case should own the problem, even as we keep them accountable once they're given the authority to run. So right now we actually have, I think I mentioned it earlier, the PPL is now being, is going to be brought to Congress, I think, by the son of the president. There's a new draft. I haven't seen the draft, so I cannot comment on it. And the president said that he will sign the draft on Monday, but I don't really know what he means by signing, because he said, I will sign the draft, but I will not submit it yet because I'm waiting for Lourdes Iswari to tell me what he also wants. The idea is to converge what the MILF and the MNLF wants, and then for the president to bring that to Congress. My unsolicited advice here is, whatever the president brings to the Congress, he himself should be the one to actually get Congress to approve it, because then he would have the numbers. He should not leave it to other people. The technical, yes, but he himself should make sure it gets passed. I mean, I don't know if that would have happened if Pinoy did the same thing last time around. Of course, Mama Sapano happened, and Pinoy was a bit, President Aquino was immobilized by Mama Sapano, and was not really able to recover in terms of getting the PPL passed. But everyone I've talked to that really knows this religious extremism issue, the issue of ISIS, Maute, whatever you call them, says that the reason why it has become so attractive to young Muslims, Muslim men particularly, young Muslims particularly, is because they have lost hope on the peace process. Because the peace process was not able to deliver what they thought it would deliver 4 years ago, when we signed the comprehensive agreement on the Ban Samoro. Whether we can still stem it back, that's the challenge. I know Marawi very well. I've taught in Marawi quite a lot of times, not there, even lately. All my life I've been going to Marawi, from again to Oro, but in recent years I've been going there as well, and at night, I won't say where I sleep for security reasons, but at night, among soldiers, among local soldiers, policemen, local security, you know the DVDs they watch? They watch DVDs of propagandas of ISIS and all of these things. That's what we're up against. And they see that as heroes, because, you know, the old fight, the revolutionaries of MNLF and MILF have not delivered what they should be delivered. So maybe we should try this time. In any case, my point is we must do this right, or else the consequences are deadly and long-term. The next part is related to that, because I think the declaration of martial law and the suspension of the privilege of habeas corpus is not necessarily a good thing for dealing with the problem. It might be sexy, it might be but it creates certain things that might not be be good over the long run. Legally speaking, I am actually taking the position that legally speaking it's justified in Marawi. I never mind the debate whether it's rebellion or terrorism. I think rebellion, terrorism is subsumed under rebellion, and this was rebellion, and on its face it's very difficult to argue that there was no rebellion, actual rebellion that endangered public safety in Marawi. But there's nothing on the record In turn, the two records here is the proclamation 216 and the president's report to Congress. If you read them, there's nothing there that justifies declaring it for the rest of Mindanao, except like an overall speculation that this will go to other parts, but no intelligence reports, no nothing. Now, the administrators of martial law went on executive session with the Supreme Court last Thursday, I think. Maybe they told them something there. But based on the document that we have, there is no evidence that it has spread, you know, that it's not just rebellion. Because there is rebellion all over the Philippines. There are NPAs, there are communists, underground communists who are fighting to overthrow the government here in Metro Manila. But you don't declare martial law because there's no danger of public safety with the rebels. There are rebels in different parts of the Philippines, NPA in different parts of the Philippines. We don't declare martial law just because there's rebellion. You declare it when there's rebellion and there's public safety. And procure that assistance in Marawi, but elsewhere is not. Congress, I think, should have convened to review Proclamation 216. They did a very big disservice. Later on, one of the bad things I will point out is the abuse of power in Congress. Incredible abuse of power going on in Congress. And we'll pay for that for a while. Now, should have convened to review Proclamation 216. But anyway, in all this debate, especially in the Supreme Court, I was in the Supreme Court almost every day. Well, like the first day, I had colleagues following it. It's very interesting that everyone agreed, the justices, the Solgen agrees that what martial law means under the 1987 Constitution is actually not, doesn't mean much from a legal point of view. That's why I say I'm right now for almost everything the military is doing in Malawi to deal with the problem. But none of that requires martial law. None of that requires martial law. Some of that would require the suspension of the privilege of habeas corpus. Those that allows you to arrest people without warrant, but only for 3 days, because in 3 days you still have to charge them. Well, what's clear is that under the 1987 Constitution, martial law has been sanitized from its original meaning. Certainly from its meaning under Marcos. Marcos used martial law, not in its original sense. Martial law was supposed to be for World War II. I mean, if you look at the history of martial law, it was really developed because we thought that there was going to be war with Japan, and where they were going to be, the German war was about to erupt, etc. So we will have to prepare for that there would be no government, and therefore only the military could govern. That's the meaning of martial law. Only the military could govern. And so therefore, to have some safeguard, you say the president is still on top of the military when the military governs. If you ask me, the only time that's really clear that has been happening in the Philippines is actually when Haiyan, Yolanda hit Tacloban. And almost all of the local government was wiped out, if not physically. They could not come to office because they themselves were affected. Remember, there were people, the business community in Tacloban actually asked President Aquino to declare martial law. That actually is the classic meaning of martial law. Chaos on the street, you need to come in. But Marcos distorted that, and unfortunately the Supreme Court legitimized it by using it for reforms, by using it to extend his power beyond his term. So now the Supreme Court sanitized all of that, and we basically have a toothless martial law from a legal point of view. But in terms of civilians, in rural areas and in war zones, it is a scary proposition still. I've talked to parish priests in Mindanao, not necessarily in the Marawi area, and they say, well, you know, in our places, the military is already very powerful. And then you give them martial law, then they even feel more powerful than they already have. So it still means something in those areas. But from a legal point of view, martial law, the soldier himself said that, martial law, he said, is a calling out power, the power of the president to order the military to suppress lawless violence in steroids. Meaning to say, its impact is only psychological. And that's where I contest it, because I think martial law is played into the hands of the terrorists who wanted this recognition. who wanted, in fact, to be recognized by the ICC, but the story is that they were not yet recognized, but by doing the marami, as apparently they have now been recognized. Certainly they have been, the propaganda machine of ISIS and other extremist groups have been lobbying them. Thing to watch is in a couple of weeks, the Supreme Court decisions on these issues, particularly the three things is legal validity of martial law based on meritorious suspicion basis. Congress, can Congress be required to convene? I think they can, but the problem is they cannot be ordered to. In other words, the court can say they should have convened, but the court doesn't have any power to order Congress. Because you cannot order Congress to do anything. You can only declare an act of Congress unconstitutional. But this one is a non-act. So the Supreme Court will have to find a remedy for a non-act. If it was a law or a resolution, the court would actually say that is unconstitutional and has no legal effect. And then the third point that the Supreme Court will rule on is my last point about what martial law means, which is very, very important for the future. The bad, I would say that the war against drugs that targets the poor is bad. I mean, the war against drugs, I'm fine with that. The fact that Duterte is the first president that made it a priority is a good thing. But the approach in doing it, which violates basic norms of human rights and human dignity, is simply not acceptable, and the country will pay for that for a long time. So it's positive that Duterte recognized part as a positive thing, but it's factually inaccurate. For example, the debate on the number of drug addicts and the fact that he fired the chairman or one of the persons of the drug dangerous drugs board. It's not right and just, and the impunity here will haunt us for decades. A long-term effect is the PNP's compromise, long-term. Many of its officers, including the best ones, are compromised. They have a Damocles sword in their hands for the rest of their career because there will be retribution, there will be accountability, there will be investigations in the next government or years after that even. So far, the military has been resisting it, being engaged in the war against drugs, and President Duterte has been trying to induce them to come in, but so far they have resisted, and they should. Those they too will be compromised. There have been consequences to our standing in the United Nations, consequences to relations like the European Union, including potential aid, well, there are already aid consequences, but also trade consequences. And I would say there's a strong likelihood of a case in the International Criminal Court against the president. I'm not in favor of that case. You know why? Because that once the case is filed, it will contain a judgment that the legal system in the Philippines is a failure. That there is absolutely no accountability in the Philippines. And I don't think we're actually there yet. I think that there is a legal system. It's imperfect. Lots of work has to be done, but I don't think we can say that we are a failed state at all. I'm against it. But I say there's a strong likelihood because it is so always in the, it's top of mind for the people in this field. It's top of mind. It's something they wake up every day, they see in headlines every day. Maybe because of the language of the president. So I'm going to predict that such a case will actually happen. And there will be consequences also for that. The bad, I think the Chinese policy of the president, particularly the dispute with China on territories, is a disservice to the country, has long-term consequences on our legal position. I am in favor of an independent foreign policy, certainly more independent than what we had under Aquino or even previous to that. But I think it's confusing execution of what that independent foreign policy is, because that doesn't mean you actually let go of allies or alienate your allies. And I think we have done that. Obviously, the relationship to the U.S. Is now very important, that now that religious terrorism that's reaching up to the top of the agenda because, you know, the U.S. is deep into that all over the world. And we've had this relationship with the U.S., I mean, on dealing with religious extremism for quite a while. That's how the U.S., that's why the U.S. became very interested in the MILF peace process in the last 10 years because precisely of that. But the state of the justice system, I think, is bad. The latest, as you can see, is the Espinosa case, where a clear case of murder was downgraded so that they could release the people who killed Espinosa, which was what you would call an execution in jail. And now you have the Secretary of Justice claiming that he did not even sign the downgrading of the charges now that the Senate is after him. I think I would predict very clearly to you that the next government, De Lima, will be released on the first day. Because from the very beginning, that prosecution was tainted with lack of due process. Whether it's true or not, that doesn't matter. It was tainted with lack of due process, and under a previous case called Aquino versus Enrile versus Broca, during Marcos, the Supreme Court had said, when a case, from the very beginning, when it is filed for political reasons and not for anything else, it is, from the very beginning, invalid. I'll finish in a couple of minutes. Opportunity, and then I would monitor what to expect from the corruption cases, I mean, the PDAF, etc. I actually am not sure how that is progressing. I mean, but it's an opportunity to remake our justice system, I guess, after this, and make it more accessible and efficient and independent from politics. I have to say, as an observer of American politics and American legal system, how envious I am that the United States Department of Justice system is relatively insulated from politics and that they could move against a president like Trump with what they're doing now, because there's something in the system that is impervious or resistant of politics. This is the last one. Corruption in high levels. You know, this is just an example of what happened to the immigration deputy commissioners in the Jack Lang case. There's this accusation now against the three DILG undersecretaries, but practically the whole bureaucracy of DILG. But more important, and hopefully that will not be a bad but a good, is the president will appoint a new ombudsman in 2018. And that's going to be crucial for corruption, dealing with corruption under the current government. No? I think it's going to be the last one. The abuse of power in Congress. I mean, I'm really appalled at the extent with which, especially the House of Representatives, just because of their numbers, are getting away literally with something akin to murder. And, I have to say, this started during President Aquino's time, where the opposition is just completely ignored. In GMA's time, because she was so vulnerable, she was more sensitive to opposition. But starting with President Aquino, the supermajority, and now under Duterte, where only numbers count, we're up with, you know, with such abuse of power, the way extrajudicial killings, for example, were dealt with in the Senate, the way Secretary De Lima and his driver, Diane, was dealt with in the House, the impeachment being railroaded with new rules. I mean, I would suspect, of course, they would never get the numbers for impeachment on both form and substance, but they just railroaded it and changed the rule from the Corona impeachment. Because at least certainly that should have required investigation, which they did for Corona, even when they didn't have even the evidence as well for Corona. It's the same people, by the way, that have been doing this. I mean, the same people that railroaded that Corona's impeachment are also the same people that are in guilty of abuse of power in Congress, in my view. The Gina Lopez rejection is another example. And then lately is the Marcos Fariñas fight in the House of Representatives, where incredibly the House of Representatives asked three Court of Justice of Appeals to give them a show cause order. Unheard of. Unheard of that you ask a judge, a justice, to explain to Congress why they decided like this, unheard of, which led to an unheard of letter from the Chief Justice and Presiding Justice of the Court of Appeals to the House and saying, please reconsider that. They're very, very polite. But there was kind of a hint there that we can also disbar you, the lawyers there. Because I think the lawyers in the House, representatives who are doing this, should also be disbarred. Because it's just gross ignorance of the law and it's abuse of power. Finally, this is the final one, the thing of our democracy, distrust, even hatred among and between parties. I really don't know how to deal with this. The misogyny, you know, the favorite trinity of De Lima, Rivera, Sobredo being attacked, that's every day. But also attacks on Bongbong Marcos and counter-attacks on that. I think it's rooted in the GMA and Pinoy eras and in 2016 election strategies. We saw this being tested against Binay, against Grace Paul, and others. I mean, and social media providing the means. And here, I want to challenge you to ask, I think for the citizens here, how can we move out of this spiral of destruction? Because it's not very healthy for our democracy to have this kind of state that we are in the way we debate. So uncertain, this is just some of the list of the uncertainties that you're not sure. Military appointments, I think it will increase. There will be more military people appointed. I'm actually not upset about that. In a way, I welcome it. President Duterte is a limited group of people, his friends from Davao, his colleagues from Davao, his brothers from San Beda, and then after that there's really no one else. So I feel safer than getting from the military, at least we know the records of those people, because they have long records. So I think it will continue to happen. The DNR, people have asked me what will happen without GNLF, I actually don't know. The current secretary has kept things as is, including has not reversed any of Secretary Lopez's decisions, which tells you that he's trying to study what's happening. He will be reasonable about what to move forward on. I'm hopeful with that. I'm hopeful on climate change and disaster risk reduction that they're able to finally move forward on this. It's a very important issue for us, but our two institutions are not in good shape, are not designed well. It's not the individuals. I've worked with all the individuals on climate change, given that's my field. And with the disaster people, I've worked with them. But they're all flawed from an institutional point of view. And it's very scary, particularly for disaster, if you hit a big disaster, and we don't have the right structure to deal with it. There are three secretaries not yet confirmed, Tagiwalo, Mariana, and Ubial. Those are important appointments. I don't know what the president will do if they're bypassed and Congress already adjourns, or if they adjourn and whether the president is reappointed them. But it's uncertainty. The president is set to appoint two new Supreme Court appointments this next month or so. Very important appointments to make. And another 6 to 7, actually 8 more, because the first two he appointed will also retire in the next 2 years. And if he appoints two people that also retires in 2 years, then if the president gets to appoint actually a total of 14, 15 during his term, that will reshape the Supreme Court, having implications by, let's say, 2020 on the Marcos VP protests, on other election-related cases, we go to 2022 on martial law, of course, that will have especially martial law is declared nationally. The vice president pro tempore, in my view, that won't get to resolution until 2020, 2021, in my view. But, there's always ways to accelerate the case, and so we have to watch out for it, we have to be vigilant about it. So far, the Supreme Presidential Electoral Tribunal has been doing what they're supposed to do. Similar to what they did with Rojas to Binay, to Legarda with Noli de Castro. Which tells you, they follow that, this case will not be resolved until the end of the term. But people don't believe that. And people don't believe me when they say that, but it's what it looks like. Traffic, I'm sure this is, I always put this from my old gents. I just put it as uncertain. I start to think of putting it into the bag. This was my last point. I was very hopeful. I like Secretary Tagada. I like Chairman Del Grau, LTFRB. Both honorable people, hard workers. No? There's a good MMT chair, Danny Ling, you know, very strong, a good team. But it's really not clear to me whether they have a strategy. Other than the long-term strategy of billboard trains, etc., which we know has to be done anyway. From what I know, they have given up on emergency powers, which is alarming because that means they have no plan. Because I know, working with Senator Grispo on this and others involved, that Congress was more than willing to give them emergency powers. But Congress has said that you have to tell us what you will do with emergency powers. Give us a plan. We cannot give you a powers and then you don't tell us what you... And apparently they have not been able to come back and say, okay, this is what we will do with emergency powers. But, you know, give them another 6 months to a year, I suppose, whether it's a short-term or medium-term solution. Otherwise, the build, if designed properly, could solve it, but it will take another 10 years of what we are facing before we can get that solution. Constitutional change, is it still doable? Yes, but the time frame is narrowing. The president created a constitutional committee in December, but has not appointed members of the committee. From what I heard, he's waiting for the BBL to be finalized to show what he's willing to concede to the Moros, the Moro groups, so that will become then the template of federalism in the country. The options for federalism are the classic federalism of having states, or my preference is simply to have regional governance. I think the country needs regional governance badly. And so we have to reallocate powers from the national to regional centers, keep the current powers, even give more power to the local governments, and the more power to local governments, I actually think it's always better. There's a link here to the peace process to both the Senate, the NDFP, and also the MILF process. So the scenarios for constitutional change is, well, if assuming Duterte does appoint the Constitutional Committee in June or July, it will take a year for the committee to work, with consultations, etc., before it goes to Congress. It will not be a convention, so it will now go to Congress as Constitutional Assembly, who will then deliberate on it. I suppose they will not accept everything that the committee will propose. But they're running out of time because this has to be done before October of 2018. Because October 2018 is the filing of candidacy for the 2019 elections. If you hold the 2019 elections under the 1987 constitution, wala na, di ba? You have to respect the mandate of the senators, of whoever was elected in 2019. No? So the window is narrowing, but I think it is still doable. I'm uncertain about how to judge this, the presidential style, which is clearly based on the past experience as mayor. We elected him because he was mayor and a successful mayor. On one level, I think there was an article of Marites Vipug that Duterte showed incompetence and inability to govern in the national perspective, and she gives examples of that. Yet on another level, being mayor, very practical, very direct engagement with the people. For some, the president is the one with the most common touch and empathy so far that we have as a president. I mean, I think only a president in Duterte who was a mayor would go to as many wakes as his president is doing, honestly. I remember with what President Duterte is doing, Mayor Jesse Robredo. Because Mayor Jesse Robredo used to tell me, one reason he won in all elections, because he would always attend in Naga City every week, every baptism, and every wedding that he was invited to. Every. Busat Watts mayors do. They're like, that's why they call him Tatay Digong. They're like, the tatay of the city. Now, whether that's good for the county at a higher level, whether it affects its competence and ability to govern is another thing. But certainly, there's an impact on our culture, on the personalistic style and temper, including language, on our political culture. And then the mother of all uncertainty, presidential health. I will not speculate, I really don't know, except I know that he takes private time, yes. The first president to use private time officially was President Aquino. I'm sure President GMA and everyone else took private time, but they did not announce it. President Aquino was one of the first to use that. This president has really used it a lot. Again, I think the next few days, he says he will take private time. I'm actually, from a point of view exposure, I think the president is overexposed and should be more circumspect about his schedule, given his age, given you know, I imagine what the impact on you if you go to several weeks in one day. And have the kind of empathy. That is good, but that's also bad for you. You absorb all of that. You absorb all the negativity. The president is actually very negative as well in his language and people. But I think overall it's positive, his foreign trips, his visits to the Peruvian, we just need to be more circumspect about it. In any case, the constitutional provisions are clear. He's actually right about succession. There is no doubt that if something happens to him, the succession will happen. I have no doubt it will happen, as provided. And for when, if he's truly sick, the constitutional provisions are also clear about who should be informed, who should have access to him, what happens if he's temporarily not able to make decisions. So to end, what can citizens do? I mean, I think the most important, along the way, I've done that, but I think the most important thing is inform and educate ourselves. I think we have to do that. We have to bother to try to go to sources ourselves so that we're able to discern fake news, polarized views. I really implore everyone to see both the good and the bad. Because if we don't see that, then I think your view of everything will be so distorted. And when there's something bad, we oppose it, we correct it, we push back on the bad. We should do that. And if there's something good, we should support that. I mean, I've pointed out to some of the really good things that this government is doing. Well, there's going to be pushback. Tax reform will not be a walk in the park because there will be, in fact, vested interests that will dilute it, that will try to stop it. The NFA importation is not necessarily a done deal. It could be reversed again unless we actually show that we support it. We consolidate the gains. For me, the peace process, I'd be very happy if at the end of the term, we have a completed peace agreement, which included most of our presidents. I say look beyond the 30 as this age will pass, as Marcos did, as other political regimes do, no? And learn the lessons and make sure that only the good is repeated and we never repeat the bad again. Thank you, I look forward to your questions later.